What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Third Person. I'm Chris. That's Mike. And guess what? You know who those guys are. I think you know. We don't even have to tell you, but we will. Daniel and Sherman Augustus. What is going on, guys? You got Nathaniel Moon and Sonny Sanzo. You know what, man? You're Sonny, dude. Come on.
I know, he didn't like it. He didn't like
I don't like the name either. When I kept hearing, I never listened to the name. Like when people said Sanzo, I like never looked. Oh, he's talking about me. Yeah, that's right.
He's talking to me.
Was it Sanzo on the call sheet?
Well, that's no. Babu calls me Sanzo. Sanzo.
Right. Yeah. Sanzo, brother.
I was gonna put out a hashtag, not my Sanzo. But guys, you guys are here. We're talking about the premiere.
Yes.
Again, thank you very much. I'm sure everyone watching this is like, this is awesome. You know, this is like our own little WonderCon right here. Yeah, right, Mikey?
That's right.
So we want to just start off. What did you guys think of the premiere when you saw it? Like, what did you guys think? You didn't see it together, right? You probably saw it separately.
No, I saw the premiere. I saw iterations of edits, but I saw the final version at C2E2, the Chicago Comic-Con thing, with the fans on a big screen. So that was amazing. Awesome. That was amazing. It's really great to see it with the fans because they're laughing in places and blah, blah, blah. And when you're watching it on your own, you don't get that reaction.
Right, yeah.
Especially with TV stuff. You don't ever get that reaction. But to watch it with the crowd and, like, you know, when they're oohing and aahing over the action, plus the laughing at, you know, Baji and all that kind of stuff, all the jokes, like, it just made it extra special and extra nice. So it was cool to see it with the whole group. And I also, like, I forgot what the storyline was and everything. And it was a great episode to kind of bring you back because everybody was in it. All the storylines started to converge a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
So it started to focus you on, like, okay, what are these last episodes going to be about?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And so I thought it was a great premiere, a really great premiere.
Oh, man. They both opened up. Both episodes opened up with some widow fighting. Master stuff. I mean.
Then how was that widow versus widow fight, man?
Oh, that was dope, right?
You know, a lot of the like the altered reality widow stuff, like just the cinematography and the colors.
Beautiful
colors. When she was fighting the ninjas in the trees and everything.
But seriously, that one-on-one was, it was probably one of the, some of the best stuff that you guys not only choreographed and filmed, but edited. Like, I was looking for the edit. Dude,
super challenging to make that, you know?
I can't imagine. I was like, oh my God, and she just had to turn and then that, and then the blood on her face, and then when she turned, then I was like.
Okay, rewatch it again and look for the specific shot that our guy Vidan, one of our stunt guys, but also our editor did.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
she jumps off the top of the balcony.
Yep.
The camera follows her down, one shot. You see her back, then it switches to the other widow, and you see her face all in one shot, right?
All
and
it continues.
Right? Yep, dude, I watched that scene three times already. I know exactly.
That required the camera to be on a wire and Vidan to catch the camera as they threw it down off the top of the balcony.
Yeah, wow.
And then he had to run and catch up to widow and get that shot. You know, it was complicated. It took many, many, many takes to get it, and they were about to give up, and he's like, no, give me one more chance. And he did it.
And he did it.
And like, only a stuntman camera. Operator could do it. Like a regular camera operator couldn't do it because he knows the action and he's able to be on a wire to do it and all this kind of stuff. And so it was amazing. That whole scene is amazing.
Because I went by there one day when Andy was like walking around and he was thinking about it. He was trying to conceive this whole thing. I'm like, man, Andy, you okay? He was like, I'm thinking. So
It's, you know, it's a metaphorical fight. And so there's all the symbolism in that fight. Visual symbolism that I think Andy Chang did an amazing job.
Amazing.
Doing. I think it was one of the best fights that so far. I mean, we have lots.
You have lots.
That one was brilliant. It was brilliant.
Yeah, the whole widow, that whole concept. And it's funny, like Mike and I said in the review on our other video, like there's something with this dark chi, man, where you have to fight yourself because MK had to do it.
Yeah.
You know? And what's interesting is even I'm just realizing this now, the dark chi version of the person, they're actually the light. They're actually the good person. Because even in when MK fought himself that like second time, he was like, no, hold on. I'm going to give you the real deal here. So I was saying to Mike, and like the widow we've seen the entire time up to that point was not the real widow, was not Minerva. It was the widow. And Minerva was waiting to come out. And like she said, you know, I'm the light version of you. Like I'm the light. And, you know, so I just, and then the fact that she's in the black makes us feel like, but that's the old widow. And it's like, I think what you guys did was such a mind trip.
Right.
Like
that, it definitely was. Because it comes from,
like, are you familiar with, like, ayahuasca? Have you heard that?
Yeah, but I'm not too familiar.
And peyote or whatever. There's an author called Carlos Castaneda, which he explored a lot of this idea of what it basically is. It's a drug that Native American warriors took. When they're like 13 or 14, it's based off like a cactus or root or something like that.
Yeah.
You take it your body rejects it, and you just vomit, and then you go into this hallucinatory state.
Okay.
Where in that state, you face your dark side.
Yeah.
Right? And the point is that you have to face that dark side. You can't run away from it. You have to fight him and win in order to become a true man. Mm-hmm. Right? And so we took that idea and made it part of these people's journeys, you know, Aramis's journey as well, or MK's journey, as well as the widow's journey, mm-hmm. because they have the dark she in them and they need to understand themselves in order to harness this power. Yeah. And so we took an idea and tried to extrapolate on that. Mm-hmm. And so not only character writing wise, but through the fight as well,
yeah.
we tried to visually show that metaphor, you know.
Yeah,
mission. It's about spiritual growth.
Yeah, I know, mission accomplished.
So let me ask you this, all right? So how does this gift work, man? Like,
that's
bad. So bad. So the more you use it for bad, right? It corrupts you.
Yes.
But the monks and the master, they're not using it for bad. You know, is it killing them when they use it?
They're healing. They're
healing, right?
They're healing.
So there you go. Yeah, like it's like, that.
It's like the quote that the master told the widow is, it's supposed to set you free.
Mm-hmm.
The power. And those were great back and forth with the master.
Listen,
and the widow.
You guys, what are you guys doing?
Very,
with
yeah,
us?
Very epic,
you guys are like
very epic kung fu film, like mythology, you know?
Yeah.
Which
yeah.
was a hint to that when Baji healed Rin.
Right.
When he was subsiding her pain.
Right. Yeah.
Right.
The yeah. Baji fight.
Oh man!
Yeah, body fight good.
I can turn him off too, asshole. Like, just come on, man.
Yeah,
yeah.
And you had no choice. Well, Sonny had no choice but to stand there with Henry in his arms. So it's like,
right.
This is on you, brother, kind of a thing. Yeah. Let's see what you can. Let's see what you can do. But
Sherman,
what
even I forgot that. Oh, he can turn people off.
Yeah. Sherman, what did you think of this? What did you think? What did you think?
Dude, I was on the edge of my seat, just like because I got a chance to watch for real this time.
Yeah.
You know, because Moon is, you know. Back at the house, you know, working on his love muscle as he's
that's right.
You got to flex that love muscle, man.
Right.
Come on.
You know, got a little love going on in there.
I was happy to see that, man. You know?
Yeah. Definitely.
Sherman had enough fighting. He's got to have a little love, you know?
Got to have a little love, man. Got to have a little love.
I'm sure we're going to see a lot more.
Yeah,
from
yeah.
Him, right?
We can't all be hard-ass warriors.
Even Pilgrim got a little love the other night.
All right. Well, you brought it up, so let's talk about that. Because that is... You know, the whole community, I don't know if you guys have been, you know, looking at that stuff, but everyone's like, hold on, what? Did he just get a happy ending? Like, what's going on here? So we're, you know, relationship, everyone saw Cressida as a mom figure. I actually never did.
I always
assumed it was more of a relationship as opposed to a mother-son type. We know that she did take care of him and she helped him grow up and whatever, but I never saw it that way. But what got you there? What was that? Can you elaborate
it's
a bit?
It's very dysfunctional.
Yeah.
Because it's like she's like a mom, but she's also kind of like a lover.
Spiritual right? advisor, mom.
Yeah,
flag.
I'm telling you, man. You can call me whatever you want, but I dug it. It's like, it was weird.
It's like 50-50 with the community
here's one
right
thing.
Now.
Like, you've heard this thing it's that weird. Like when we... When we find our wives, we're kind of subconsciously looking for our mothers.
Yeah, that's
so it's kind of a fucked up version of that.
Yeah,
he's with this person that treats him like a son, but also she provides him with all his other physical desires as well.
Because he didn't know his mother, correct?
No, I don't think he knew his mother.
He
no.
never knew his mother.
So, but when that showed up in the script and I saw it, it was like weeks out before they had to film it. I kept running up to Babu. I'm like, are you going to do it? Because, like, you know, there's scenes that actors turn down, right? And I totally understand.
Are you going to do it?
We're just talking about that.
He's like, hell no, I'm going to do it. I'm like, seriously? I'm like, seriously? I kept thinking they weren't going to do it. I was like, when I read it, I was like, nah, they're not going to do this scene. Both of them are not going to do it. But both of them were really excited to do it.
Yeah.
It
was Lorraine.
Yeah, Lorraine. Come on. Yeah, Lorraine. Yeah, you know.
She'll do anything. But I kept going, like, I want to see the top shot. I want to
get that top
shot. Yeah, right. It's funny because in the review, maybe you guys can give us your opinions on this, but I kind of took it as, listen, with the power hungry Pilgrim, maybe this was just the first time they were ever together intimately like that. Do you guys think this has been going on or
it's been going on because the way he reacted.
See, I told you, man.
The way he reacted was not like, hey, yo, what are you doing?
Yeah,
I'm tired. I'm tired. I had a long day. This might make you feel better.
I told you, bro. Yeah. They just messed up, man.
I just think that it's like she sees...
Dude, she hangs herself with the hooks. Dude, she's messed up.
I don't know. I don't know. With the newly...
She's definitely twisted.
Yeah.
I loved it, man. I'm telling you, I loved it. I mean, My wife and I were watching, and she was like, hold on. Right. And I was like, hold on, let's go back. Let's just make what? And it was so good. But well, it was great.
There's also like that, you know, the scene where she's holding Henry and I'm staring at her.
Yeah.
Right? Oh. A lot of people are like, why is Sonny looking at her like that? Because he's fucking freaked out.
Yeah.
This crazy woman is holding my baby, and yeah, like, what's she going to do to it?
Put her down, you maniac.
Well, you walk
so like,
to her.
I'm ready to pounce on her if she does anything crazy to it. Right. So that's my look there is really like just waiting for what bad thing is going to happen.
It was like back in the day with Quinn and always holding him.
Poor Sonny, man. Poor Sonny just can't catch it. Look, there was guys, you just jam packed these two episodes so far with so much stuff, and we know there's more coming, but like all right, we talked about the tub scene. It's so much, you know.
Never I forgot
so
to
much.
Mention the Sonny Pilgrim fight. That's also was crazy.
Exactly.
So
let's off the chain.
So let's get in there, Sherman. I'm sorry. I want to talk about Sherman about
there's,
Moon for
there's
a second.
There's a lot of Moon coming up.
Coming. I know. So let's just say I was happy. I liked seeing you in that environment. You were calmed down. You're like, I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying here. You had that, you know, little couple words with Baji, you know, and let me ask you this. How many rocks hit that damn camera when he peeled off? Did you have plexiglass in front of the camera?
I was actually worried for him because I'm the only one that can drive that car.
Oh, no, really? Oh, that's right. You
I'm
said
the only
that.
One
yeah.
that can drive that car. I had a girlfriend that had that car. And the only reason why I dated her is because her brother gave her that car.
Right, yeah.
Yeah,
Mercury Cougar.
That
right?
Mercury Cougar. Yeah.
Damn. Because, I saw all those rocks spitting up at the camera. I'm like, someone had to get pegged to the rock on that one.
Oh, yeah. It was like...
Yeah. But, that was great. Yeah, so, you know, I know, dude. You're gonna kick some major ass coming up.
There's so much more later on. That. Because all roads lead to freaking Pilgrim. I mean, we all have to intertwine with that whole thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Guys,
I think you can get a sense that it's like, it's about joining forces now. And like, putting down the previous... you know, beef that everyone's had to take care of this.
Yeah, there's the
basically a nuclear bomb. That's like he's basically a nuclear bomb. He's North Korea, like in the Badlands, right? Yeah, so we got to deal with this situation.
He's sitting in his garage, soaked in gasoline, lighting matches.
Yeah, just playing that roulette. I mean, so that fight was everyone saying it in the community on Twitter and all that stuff. Sonny had that boy beat, right? Did. He had him beat, and Pilgrim cheated, but hands down, cheated. You know,
you can't. It's hard to fight. I mean, I've tried to beat people with the dark chi, and it's very difficult.
Right? I know.
I got Kung Lee, and that's the only one person that I've been able to get.
That's true. Right?
Everybody else beat the shit out of me. So
yeah,
you know, someone who's already a high level fighter and then has dark chi is just when he turns that power up on. I'm done.
Yeah, but up to that, that's why it's like, and I know you can't answer this yet, but Sonny gets that chi back, you know?
Watch out.
That's Super Saiyan time, I'm telling you.
It was great to see to a little bit of the backstory that Pilgrim told about.
And you're gonna see more of that. There's gonna be a very clear picture of what their relationship was like and where they were and all that kind of stuff. And you know, and Azra becomes more of a real thing now.
There's an awesome segment that's going to come up between Sancho and Pilgrim.
Yeah.
That's going to be awesome.
But jumping, going up the dinosaur, the skeleton, and you, it looked like you were going after Cressida, you know.
Oh, yeah, you saw her up there, and you were like, I'm about to do this. And then
caught you. Yeah,
that was pretty sick. That was
obviously the fights.
Sonny figured out that like she's his trusted advisor. He takes her out, then he loses.
Exactly,
he loses somebody very important to him.
Exactly,
he lost, but apparently he couldn't do it. Missed it by a second.
Don't worry about Chris, the guys. Don't worry about
Pilgrim Chris. Had to tackle me through that column.
Yeah. Oh, we got some coming from her. Okay, all right.
Don't worry about Chris.
Daniel, we have a question from one of the one of our community members, Keanu. She wants to know. Speaking of the Sonny and Pilgrim fight, since we're on the subject, how long did it take to choreograph that?
Well, I mean, you know how I told you before.
Yeah, you get in there.
We choreograph as we go along, right? So I think that was a 5-day fight.
5-day fight, okay.
5 days on that, 5 days on that one. Because there's two big fights in that episode. So we have 9 days per episode.
Yeah.
So
oh, man.
Like four or five for that fight, and then four or so for the other fight. Yeah. So yeah, it was long, but it wasn't as bad. Like Babu is an amazing fighter. He's actually really good. Yeah. He came into the show like he kind of missed fight camp.
Yeah.
And he was a little bit out of shape. And he's like, I'll promise you, I will be ready when it comes to fight. I'm like, okay.
Oh, nice.
And he got ready. He used to run marathons. So he was an athlete before.
Okay.
But he was definitely like 30 pounds heavier than he should have been. And he lost the weight over the time. You can't really tell because of his clothes, right? Yeah. He lost the weight and got fit, and he was strong.
He's a big dude, right?
You know where we're banging arms?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Blocking and all that. That stuff hurt.
Yeah.
It hurt a lot. he's powerful. Like, that guy is really grounded in the ground powerful. He's not like, he can't like jump around like Sonny does, but he's really grounded in the ground. And anything that comes from those arms, ooh, tough, crazy.
That's awesome. It makes it for a very physical fight. Not only visually, but you can feel that. That's amazing. That's awesome stuff.
Right. And then in that fight, we specifically jumped in close to see all the kind of arm locking details and the kickings at the shin and all that stuff, because we wanted to show kind of a Wing Chun style action there and there. And so it's not typical of what we usually do, where we're usually wider on that, but we jumped in for the close-ups to see the technique.
Yeah. Very, very, very cool.
I'll do a little bit about...
Well, go ahead. What?
You want to do it? Well, let's talk about MK and Nyx. And how those characters have changed.
MK's hair is looking fierce. That's all I got to say.
Oh, yeah. You guys said that yesterday.
He's got hair. I'm sorry, but it's amazing. It looks great. It just looks great. Is that his real hair?
Yeah.
He's been growing his hair out, but it's just like the way it's done.
He's got long hair still now.
Yep.
It's sick, man. It's sick. It looks great. I'm telling you, man.
He has to go through the crazy braiding process to get it like that.
Yeah, no, I can imagine. But it's like from MK from the beginning of the series to now, and the hatred behind his eyes.
Yeah, he's changed so much. It's sad. It's like sad to see the character start from this point of innocence to this like angry teenager, basically, is what he is now, right?
Yeah.
And like, I was looking at pictures from season one, like he was a little boy. He was a cute little boy, you know?
Yeah.
And now he's this like angry teenager that doesn't give a shit about anybody, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, we've all been there, so we understand it. Like, and Sonny totally understands him, but at the same time, he can't change his mind. Like, that's what he's going to be like. He's going to be that teenager, you know?
Yeah.
So it's a sad relationship to see Sonny and MK end up this way. You know, it was really sad.
But it was great to see the Knicks, you know, hopping in and changing pace, like stopping Pilgrim.
Yeah, stopping Pilgrim.
Right.
I loved it. Yeah. It was so good.
Right, her coming out of that kind of timid, being a pet or a dog, and then finding her own self. And
right.
And deciding to break away and going, this is all messed up. I don't want to be part of this anymore.
Well, look at what Baji was saying. Look at what Baji was saying when he was in the cage to her. He was just feeding her.
Oh, well, I mean, yeah. Well, that's Baji. That's
corruption.
Baji does what Baji does. You know what I'm saying?
Like, yeah, that's his forte. What's your worth now that Pilgrim has the gift?
But it was great. It was great to see her. It was great to see, you know, Ella Ray more and get more of, more, you know, time to speak and, like, more of her character and, like.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, really get an insight of who she was.
There's a great evolution for her. It's a great, great evolution for her right now. I'm really enjoying watching her character blossom more.
Yeah.
In which we have more characters coming, guys.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I know
There's some new characters coming.
Yeah.
More new characters. There's some new characters.
We also saw Nyx throwing a saving your rear end a little bit with your blow dart stuff.
That was cool.
Throwing a mannequin.
Yeah. Thank you. I wanted to get there. Yeah. That whole situation was awesome. Yeah. The arm through someone is awesome. Yeah. That's amazing. The blow dart.
I tweeted death by mannequin hand.
Yeah, dude. It's like, it was so cool. And it was a real, you know, it was a real like diehard situation. You know what I mean? Like you were on your own. Being chased down, about, you know? Right? Well, before that,
very, very injured.
Very injured. Oh, you got your ass beat, but you still choked the dude out, which is great. You know, I was like, where the hell did he go? I'm like, he's got to be underneath that pile, and then like he just jumped up, headbutted the dude.
A little Rambo situation.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It was very Rambo, very, you know, John McClane. It was so good, and then people are talking about. The whole one of our friends and you know the community James he mentioned like a reference to Castaway. So you're sitting there talking to Waldo and you guys did that little trick where that's a wheelchair. Wait, hold on a second, you know, and he's talking to him, and then it's a very Castaway though, you know, like talking to Wilson, you know, and then
it's also the first time you ever seen Sonny do something like that.
Yes,
he's so in his own head that it's the first time he actually verbalized.
Enjoyed that. That was awesome. Yeah. You guys jam packed so much stuff.
Yeah.
But to me, nothing felt rushed. It flowed beautifully. And that was a really great scene. And again,
I think, you know, every episode coming forward is just equally as dense because we've got a lot to do to wrap up the story. You know, and you know, we didn't know when we were making it that this would be the last season, but we did create a full stop for this part of the story.
Right.
So we're not going to leave anybody hanging. You know, at the end of the season, it's going to be a full stop, and it'll be a nice ending. Like, you could see that there's more potential for something in the future if we're lucky enough. But there's a full stop and won't leave you like just like, what the hell? Like, where's the story now?
That's what we spoke with LaToya about.
I know you have.
Yeah.
Yep.
And we can't wait. I mean, and that, you know, not to bring it down a note, but you know, it's so bittersweet, guys. It's, you know, it's like we're so excited to be, you know, seeing this again and everything, and then you know what? I feel like the more as we get close to the end, it's just gonna be equal parts. This is the shit, and damn it, you know what I mean? Right. And it's like
that's the thing. Is like, you know, I feel like we're getting to a boiling point with like fans and everybody getting into the show and mainstream people starting to fall into it. And like even the press and writings, like on Sci-Fi Wire, there was like late to the show that article,
right?
Like beautiful stuff being written, but it's like, oh man, too little, too late. You know,
I know that's
and unfortunately, like, let's address this cancellation issue. A lot of it was a business decision, like a lot of business messed up business with the way the show is distributed. And so it's just unfortunate that has nothing to do with the ratings. It's weird that they're judging it on live ratings when no one watches live shows anymore. Right. And then on top of the business, it's a purely business thing. It's not the quality of the show. It's not, you know, ratings or
anything like that.
Yeah. Just like,
no, it's because you did everything anymore. Right.
It couldn't exist anymore as a business thing for the channel, so they just had to get rid of it.
Yeah.
So having said that, then, where would you guys like to see it go?
If it continues.
You know, when we talked to LaToya, you know, we mentioned, you know, because she writes comics, we're like, what about a comic? What about an anime?
Definitely. I definitely think it'd live on in a graphic novel. I think maybe a couple one-off or two-off movies would be cool.
That would be sick.
But it depends, because AMC still owns it, so it depends on what they want to do with it. You know, we can wish for anything we want, but if they don't approve it, then we're, you know.
Where would you guys like to see it go if you had the choice? Obviously, like, we want to keep the show going, but
ideally, I'd like to do two more seasons, five seasons total.
Yeah.
You know, and that would have been good. I think 6 to 8 is unrealistic.
Yeah.
It's very expensive. It's very taxing on all of us. You know, and like the last season, this season we shot for 9 months. I never shot anything that long in my life.
Yeah.
And then the physicality of it, plus how freaking cold it is.
Yeah, we were in
Ireland. We were in Ireland, like the worst part of the time to be filming, which was like from end of August. And as soon as September hit, it started raining until May. And it was raining and cold the whole time. It was cold, snowing. Like, it never snows there. Like, all this crazy stuff happened while we were there. It was really physically difficult. Like, I don't know how many actors broke down during the film. A lot of people broke down. Crew broke down. Everyone broke down. But it was like, but we loved it. Like, the passion was there, and we just kept chugging through it. But like I said, you can't do that for 8 seasons. You go crazy.
It's a lot. Yeah.
So 5 seasons would have been great, you know?
Yeah.
But then the day, you know, that's how it's what's going to happen now. We'll see what happens.
If it goes to animation, would you guys do the voices of your characters?
No, I'd do it. Totally. Absolutely.
That's
easy.
No.
So not have to do the fights.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah. That'd be amazing, right?
Yeah, add more.
Have you guys ever done voiceover work?
Yep.
I do a character on Skylanders Academy.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
King Penn.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
I did a film called Logorama. It won an Oscar.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah. I can't believe you bring that up.
Yeah. So, yeah.
All right,
voiceover
is
fun. I love doing voiceover work because you can go really deep into a character and not feel silly. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then, and like with that Kingpin character, I wouldn't act that way in a real role, but like you can do that in real life. You know?
That's cool.
I mean, in that fantasy world.
Yeah. Cool. All right. What else we got? I mean,
I'm looking. I think we got through a lot.
It's just too much. You know, it was so good. You know, what about, so we talked a little bit about the fans' reactions now, and you guys have seen the hashtag Save the Badlands, you know, started by our friend James, you know, and I actually had a conversation with him the other day, and he was, you know, he was like, damn it, you know, just like, you know, doing the best we can. And, you know, and I was telling him, I'm like, everyone is doing what we can, you know, and unfortunately, too little too late. But you know what?
Let's be as optimistic.
You know what? You know, like, yeah, it's like, I think I'm really touched by you guys and everybody that's getting behind this. Like, I actually almost came to tears when I first saw it. Like, I was like, oh my God, these people really, and like putting in money to do sign the petition. I'm like, that's crazy.
Yeah, right.
Like, that's so crazy. But at the same time, it's like, it may help, it may not help, but like just seeing that energy is really helpful for all of us. It raises our spirits up, and everyone who's involved. It's like people do care about this show. People do love the show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so that makes us feel great. You know?
And they love you guys. They love you guys as people and actors and characters. Like, you know?
Well, it makes this thing of the thing going down like a little bit better.
Yeah. And as an actor, you want to go out on top with something like that because it lets you know that your work has been appreciated.
Right.
Yeah.
And then that's what's important. Not to be an instigator, but hey, you can focus on, we still have a chance for Emmy Awards. Right. And if we get awards, we might have a chance to revive this thing. Right.
Okay.
And action design, cinematography, and costume design were definitely our direction. Those categories were killing it in there.
Yeah. Exactly.
And we should get that respect. And I'm still fucking mad that we've never gotten an action design award. Like, okay. I don't want to name names, but I saw the submissions last year
for
what were nominated, and they're fucking horrible.
Exactly.
This one specific show. Looked like it was a showreel from the 80s. Like, the way they shot the action was like...
No, I'm going to say it. He rolled downstairs. He rolled downstairs. You rolled downstairs. How is that worth anything?
Yeah. Yes, come exactly. On. Like, in this day and age, you roll down the stairs. Come on, man.
Seriously.
Like, seriously. And so, or one of the thing I saw was a car chase where the main actor obviously wasn't driving the car, and they cut to his close up, and you can see the car's not moving in the background.
Yeah.
It's so badly done.
It's like, what are you doing?
That shit is getting nominated, and we're not, like, fuck off. Yeah. Like, seriously. And so, you know, I don't know what it is, whether it's an old boys club and we're not allowed in there because our choreographers are not American or whatever, or is it that the voters are just lazy and they don't watch everything, you know? And that's true. I've seen that happen in Hong Kong. I've seen that happen. I've seen it happen here.
Yeah.
Like, the voters don't have time to see everything. So they go, oh, those are the shows I know, and they have action, so they should be nominated. Yeah. But they don't actually know what the action is, and they don't know how to compare.
And we have some fine...
So we can get some, like, the community to get crazy riled up about that and just get out there with, like, I don't know, whatever hashtag can be about for the Emmys. That'd be amazing.
Exactly.
All right, well, now it's got to be hashtag, you know, save the Emmys or you know, right. Badlands for Emmys for Bet. We'll come up with it.
He's good at making
the hashtags. So I want to go back now because you mentioned like all the costumes and everything. And shout out to Giovanni because I just say some words. I can't. It's too much.
No, honestly, the red
kimono.
Suits. Yeah,
dude,
yeah.
The kimono Gaius's with the costume. Jacket over it.
Right.
Moon's sleeveless kimono vest.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Giovanni,
Baji looked good in his.
Everybody. I'm still digging your pimp coat. Daniel, that coat is legit.
With the fur?
Yeah.
I think that's my favorite outfit because there's nothing, there's no bullshit on it.
Yeah.
And I can move well in it.
You're not punching aluminum cans and shit. Yeah.
It's just the sweater. Like the chow outfit, I hated the most, that white one.
Yeah, I remember you saying that. Yeah.
It like rubbed my neck and I got sores from it and all kinds of stuff.
I mean,
like,
you look dope as hell in it, but I know it wasn't comfortable.
Yeah. And I also like, I just don't like wearing all white. But the point is like, yeah, that jacket is my favorite thing.
That's
it was warm.
Yeah.
It was like, it was great.
Yeah.
At first when I saw it, I was like, I don't know if this is sunny, but then I just like put it on and was like, oh yeah, I kind of like this.
No, that was cool. When we saw those promo pictures, you know, before the season started, it was like, oh, that looks fucking cool.
Right.
Yeah. You guys, I mean, obviously, you know, Giovanni, like he just, what he makes.
It's insane.
And I have to say we had real serious craftsmen working on those costumes. Like in our production facility, there was one giant room that was like a half a swimming pool. It was a swimming pool they covered up. And it was just all Italian seamstresses.
That's crazy. And
Giovanni's team. Yeah. Like, they didn't even speak English.
Well,
like,
there were
some from Ireland.
One girl from Africa.
Yes, from Africa. Yeah. But there were, like, serious craftsmen making custom-made haute couture outfits for everybody, you know? And then multiple versions of it because you have to have a fight version, you have to have a costume version, blah, blah, blah. you know, all that stuff.
Double version, yeah.
And so mm-hmm. a double version for the doubles, you know, all that kind of stuff. So it was not easy for them to do this show. Yeah. But they busted some ass to make it,
they
make
did.
It work.
They did. He's awesome.
Yeah, and putting that cinematography and the way you guys shot those scenes just enhanced the colors of it. Like I mentioned before about, you know, the widow fighting, you know, the ninjas, the blue, how it just stuck out with the guys that were in the trees.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
just that red just looked insane. And
or even like the alkalites, the pilgrims alkalites in their kind of like this hippie kind of Burning Man outfit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I kept calling them burners on set because they look like they're like going to go to Burning Man next week.
Yeah.
but that helps with this idea that it's a cult, right? Because
mm-hmm.
Burning Man is a little tribe cult thing,
that's
right? And that's what it is. And like every other utopian society, it starts off with good intentions, but it ends up being like, you know, human nature gets involved and then people screw up and it becomes dark.
It goes left. You know?
And that's exactly what the Pilgrim and his acolytes are.
Those guys are pretty cool. And like you're saying, like the makeup and stuff, like Cressida's makeup, like even just the makeup for everybody. Look, we've said this 1,000 times, you guys, and we'll keep saying it. Everything that the show that you guys are able to do with the colors and the fighting and the costumes and the drama, and it's just everything comes together so good. It's so good, you know.
I was gonna
ask you guys about one, I was gonna ask you if there's anything you can tell us that you can tease us a little bit, but maybe we'll save that for the end. What I wanted to ask you is about the gift, like, you know, so we don't know whether Sunny is or isn't going to get it. We don't know if Minerva's going to get it back yet. She went through that whole thing, and now she maybe has a better understanding. She seeks out Sunny. We see that's going to be coming up, and that's what's coming up, you know. But as far as, like, the gift, so Pilgrim used some of his energy to give to mm-hmm. the Alkalites.
Yeah.
Is he powering down? Because, like...
it's replenishable. So like when he does like a dozen alkalites like that, it drains him for a bit and he has to recover.
And then it
comes
back up. Yeah.
Right. I think Cressida does say that to him, right? And he's like, no, I'm fine.
Oh yeah,
come back, right? But it's not clear whether if you keep doing misintentioned things, how that's going to affect you. You know what I mean? Like what it did to MK when you're doing bad stuff, like it takes energy out of you, you know? Yeah. And if you're doing good stuff, you can maintain it. So that stuff will be answered later. You know, those things will be answered later. Yeah.
That is a legit metaphor for real life. Mm-hmm. The more negative energy you give off or live in,
it's like poison.
Your life's going to suck.
Yeah.
You know?
And like a lot of cancer comes from that. Like
absolutely.
Cancer comes from like negative, pessimistic.
Absolutely, man. Don't get me started on talk. Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
You want to cure cancer? Make people laugh. Get people's energy.
You know, I have a friend that got nasal cancer and he was stage 4. He's going to die, right?
That's crazy.
It's like it was inside his face, right? But he just was like the most positive person in the world and he got through it and he cured himself.
And awesome. It happened.
You know, I mean, he also went through chemo and radiology and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But then I had a very similar friend that went through the same thing who was like, this sucks. I'm going to die, blah, blah, blah. And he died.
Sucks.
And so it's like how you treat, how your attitude is toward it. And actually, I believe that a lot of the stresses and emotional strains that you go through life are hidden away in your body somewhere.
Yeah, it manifests in any way, anyway.
Yeah.
Your arm hurts, your leg hurts, you have a headache. It's because you're holding that shit in.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
Plus it messes with your manifestation. You got to be able to see positive and clearly to manifest what you want. So
whatever you're looking for is looking for you.
Absolutely. I get a lot of like deep tissue work and stuff like that, and I've seen it happen to people where like. They get massage in one place and it unlocks something and they just start crying or they just start laughing or something happens to them. Right. So that stuff is real. And so a lot of the stuff we talked about in Badlands, when we were pitching the show,
mm-hmm.
we were trying to say that like, this seems supernatural, but it's actually really connected to what humans really can,
it's real life.
Can do. It's
absolutely.
Real life.
The energy of the earth. We're connected to the energy of the earth. We're connected to
for
each
sure.
other. Yeah.
And also, like, we know that we're not using 80% of our brain. What was that for? What are we not tapping into? You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And what is this frontal lobe for, really, if we're not really using it in real life? Like, what there's something that must be we were not tapping into. Or if you go back to, if you look at ancient history, like Egyptians, like, supposedly had all these powers. Maybe we had all these powers,
mm-hmm.
and we just got diluted all over time, you know?
It's like our appendix.
It's like Idiocracy, that movie where people just get super and super over time. You know, it's like, this is what's happened to her.
Brought to you by Gatorade.
Right?
Yeah. Brando.
Which brings Which brings it back around to when Cressida was hanging from the chains.
Yeah.
It opened up her, you know, their third eye.
Exactly,
opened
right.
Opened up a vision for her.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, you couldn't get a nice, you know, foot rub to get that happening. You had to hang from chains. That's what goes to show you. See, that's what I'm saying. There's a little something messed up with her. I love it.
Well, okay, let me tell you a real personal story. Like 2 weeks ago, I almost died.
What?
I had food poisoning, which actually turned out to be a burst appendix. I let it go for 3 days before I went to the hospital. And by the time I got there, I was so badly infected that he said if I waited one more day, I would have died.
Yeah. Oh,
right?
No.
He's like, your crazy tolerance for pain because you do martial arts almost killed you, right?
Holy cow.
But so I spent a week in a hospital reflecting on that stuff, and it opened up some weird channel in my head, and I feel like completely clear, like so much clarity on just everything in my life. Yeah. And then I realized, like, that physical experience of being in pain for 3 days, like, it was really painful, I have to tell you. It was like, I was telling Sherman, it's like being kicked in the balls every 10 minutes. That's what
it
felt like.
Oh, no. Jesus.
Right? And I stuck through it for 3 days, right?
Wow.
But something, that pain, going through that, like, opened some other weird channel up in my brain, and I feel like a different person right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. So, I'm so happy that you made it through.
Yeah, absolutely. So, all these things that the characters are going through is based in reality, is based on real stuff. It may seem like fantasy, but it's really based on things that, like, really exist in this world.
Yeah, I mean, that's one reason why the show speaks to me personally, obviously. Yeah. I saw the correlation right away. You know, that's how I live my life. That's what I practice in my life, and I've been doing it for years. And so that was like, boom, I like this a lot, you know? But yeah. All right, so we're not going to keep you too much longer. Can you guys tease anything? Can you guys give a little, any little bits or anything? Or what do you
Well,
think?
Sunny sister is coming.
Yep.
That she's coming, and I can tell you she's played by a dear friend of mine, Eugenio Yuan, who's the daughter of Cheng Pei Pei, who is the Silver Fox in Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Yeah. Okay.
She was a very famous Shaw Brothers actress, one of the first female Kung Fu stars.
Wow.
Her mom. And I worked with her mom on two movies before in the past, and never worked with Genia, but I knew her really well. And so I brought her up when I saw the sister character. I brought her. I was like, we got to get her.
Nice.
So we hired her for it. And it was like the first, as that executive producer, first opportunity to be able to hire a friend.
Which she says hi, because I spoke with her earlier today.
Yeah. Oh, yeah?
Oh, wow.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Hi.
Hello.
So we can't wait to talk to you.
That's right.
She's going to bring something really cool to that role. And that role is just going to open up a whole other Pandora's box about Sonny's past.
That's going to be awesome. Cool.
A lot of questions.
And I know we got some more. I know Moon. I want to see what else you got in that hand of yours, man.
There's a whole bag of tricks in that hand, you know.
You think Lydia likes him just because he's a nice guy? Yeah. Come on, that hand's got some power.
Oh,
in
man.
Him, we love muscle. Oh, we got to flex that love muscle.
We're going to have a second tub scene.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we're going to have another tub scene. I got you, guys. Heard you loud and clear. Fine. Right? Daniel's going to call for that top shot. It'll be fine. It'll be good.
Awesome.
All right, guys, you know what? Well, I mean, we could sit here for hours and talk.
Yeah.
You guys, thank you again so much for being here. And
together, yes.
Together. It's so awesome. It's just great to see you guys together in the same room. And
the great thing is we're all going to be together for WonderCon.
Yep.
And that's going to be the first time we've been at like a public event together. Like most of us, Aramis, Allie, Lewis, Sherman.
Yeah.
Not Babu and Lorraine, they're away.
Yeah.
Nick is away working on something.
Emily's away.
But a lot of us will be there, and it'll be the first time that a lot of the cast will be together.
That's
so
awesome. Yeah, that's going to be in Anaheim? It's
in Anaheim, And also, it'll be the first time I've seen everybody since we found out we got canceled. So that'll be an emotional
moment. There's going to be lots of drinks, I'm sure.
lots
of drinks after that night,
I don't drink anymore, but I might have a drink that night.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. Well, hey, listen, you're feeling better, right?
I'm feeling good. I lost like 12 pounds. I'm 159 pounds. Like, I haven't been this skinny since I was in high school.
Oh, wow.
Because when I was in the hospital, I was not allowed to eat. So I didn't eat for 9 days.
That's crazy.
So I'm now trying to rebuild my body. But emotionally, I feel great. Mentally, I feel really strong.
Good.
So I have two more weeks before I can do anything physical because they're afraid I might get a hernia.
Yeah.
But and it's been painful not to be able to work out because that's part of my life.
Oh, no, Well, so put that weight back on, and then, you know.
Yeah. I'm eager to jump back into it and get stronger than I was before. So
cool. All right.
Awesome.
I was going to say one last thing. What? Is there anything that you guys are working on? Badlands, you finished that. But is there anything that you guys want to maybe plug or that you can talk about?
I did a movie in China in October. We finished right before Christmas. And that's coming out in August. They will probably be in small releases here in the States. It's called It's a terrible English name. It's called Crime Solved on Time.
Okay.
But the Chinese name is much more compelling. But it's a heist movie. I play this. This is basically kind of Heat and Catch Me If You Can tied together. Okay. It's about a group of robbers that actually existed from 1989 to 1999 in China. And they would just go in and rob banks. This guy, the leader of the gang, figured out the way to get anyone to do anything you want is to just kill someone first, ask for what you want, and you'll get it. Because like cops and security at that time didn't have guns on them. In fact, guns are not that common in China. So he had one gun, and he went in there, blasted people, and was able to do this for 10 years straight.
Wow.
So it's about the cops trying to figure out who did this and how they get to him. And eventually, you know, technology catches up to him. There's CCTVs, all that kind of stuff.
Right, yeah.
And he gets caught in the end. But it was a really fun movie to make, to like be a heist leader. I've always wanted to do a heist film.
That's awesome.
Also to like hold an AK-47 and shooting it down the street in China was really fun.
We're gonna have to get a copy of that. Definitely see that. Yeah. Sherman,
I did LaToya's movie for her.
That's right. Yes. Oh, yeah, we've been waiting for that. LaToya. Waiting for it. Yeah.
So she directed it?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. Sherman, move to your left a little bit.
She was like, quack. Come on, Sheriff, say the line right.
Yeah, she cracked that whip on you, yeah.
She was great.
She was great. She was awesome.
Yeah. Oh, LaToya was amazing. Yeah, LaToya we had such great. A fun time speaking with her, too.
Yeah.
You know, it was really good. All right, guys, we're going to let you go. Again, thank you so much. You. Oh,
cool. Are you welcome?
Social stuff, Twitter, Instagram.
Where people can get you?
Yeah, Instagram is usually what I use, at ThatDanielWu.
Mm-hmm.
Instagram for me is ShermGus.
That's right.
Us.
You guys heard
ThirdPersonPod.com on all the Google searches, of course, guys. It was so great to have Daniel and Sherman in here with us together. Right?
Our pleasure.
Badlands is back. We're super excited about where the show is. We have six more episodes, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I mean, don't remind me, but yes.
Yeah, I know. That's what we were saying. Even in the review. You know, it's bittersweet because at the end we're always just like, oh my God.
But you know what? We're gonna enjoy the ride. We'll cry later.
It's a fun ride. The last six episodes is amazing. It's amazing. So you'll be very satisfied.
Looking forward to it. All right. Guys, thank you so much. And everyone watching, Daniel Sherman, thank you so much. We'll see you guys next time on the
Bye.
Bye-bye.